The Occult Control System. UFOs, Aliens, Other Dimensions, and Future Timelines. Written by Daniel Pinchbeck. Narrated by Daniel Pinchbeck. Part 1. From the Periphery to the Center. All of a sudden, the mainstream media has turned its focus on the subject of UFOs, a global phenomenon which has been derided and dismissed until now. The tone has shifted drastically in recent articles of the New York Times and Washington Post. Unidentified, a new series on the History Channel, exhaustively chronicles military encounters with what appear to be diverse alien craft. The Times reports on myriad anomalies encountered by pilots as recently as 2015, including a report of an object akin to, quote, a spinning top moving against the wind, unquote, and another, quote, like a sphere encasing a cube, unquote. These objects were able to accelerate to hypersonic speeds, make sudden stops and instantaneous turns with no visible engine or exhaust plumes. For some conspiracy theorists, the new spate of articles suggests we are approaching a threshold of disclosure, the long-awaited release of withheld information on UFOs and ETs. It is also possible that this partial disclosure has been orchestrated by intelligence agencies whose motives remain opaque and unclear. Whatever the truth, the issue of UFOs and the alien presence is steadily moving from the outer edge or periphery of public awareness toward the center. I would like to explore why this is happening and what it means. I will also consider what we could do, and perhaps should do, individually and collectively in response. I enjoy observing the process as once esoteric topics spiral from the edge of collective awareness toward the center. Over the last decade, another formerly taboo subject followed a similar path, namely psychedelics. Before I published my book on psychedelic shamanism, Breaking Open the Head, in 2002, you simply could not speak about psychedelic exploration in a city like New York or London if you wanted to be known as a serious, responsible person in the media or the arts. When I tried to broach the subject at a social gathering of journalists, art world aficionados, or literary writers back then, the response would be ridicule and curt dismissal. Psychedelics seemed caught in a double bind of repression. Most people not only had a knee-jerk negative reaction to the subject, but they were also unable to even consider why they felt the need to repress any interest in the subject so intensely. This is the situation today when it comes to UFOs and the question of alien contact. Over the last decade, the culture lifted its interdiction on psychedelics. They are now fashionable objects of fascination. They are promoted in best-selling books, TV shows, web magazines, and numerous documentaries. In fact, today we find ourselves in a full-fledged psychedelic renaissance, with amazing research happening all across the world. This is a great development. It also suggests that a similar reversal might happen when it comes to other prohibited areas of inquiry, such as the still-forbidden subject of UFOs and, quote-unquote, aliens. But such a mainstreaming of the alien topic can only be beneficial if we first define enough of a cultural narrative and conceptual model to give shape and coherence to the phenomenon. Through this essay, I am hoping to assist in this extremely difficult task of discernment. Dismissiveness and derision have been the dominant response to the subject of UFOs and alien abductions. Also, crop circles, a subject I explored in depth in my 2006 book, 2012, The Return of Quetzalcoatl, over decades. The thousands upon thousands of sightings of strange craft by ordinary people, as well as trained military personnel, the vast numbers of bewildering and terrifying abduction stories, the aesthetically profound, precise, and gargantuan crop circles that still appear in UK wheat fields every summer with no explanation. None of this has made any difference until now. These topics fall so far outside of mainstream discourse that you cannot explore them or even mention them without risking exile to the dismissible lunatic fringe. In fact, journalists and academics who've pursued this inquiry with some level of objectivity and rigor find themselves thrown out of the establishment, forced to build alternative structures to circulate their ideas. In my case, I wrote one article for Wired magazine on the crop circles back in 2002. I left open the possibility that it wasn't entirely a hoax. After that publication, the editor-in-chief of Wired was appalled. I was never allowed to write for the magazine again. The reasons for this blockade are, I think, quite obvious. The main function of mainstream discourse is not to excavate uncomfortable truth, but to preserve and protect the status quo. Popular media and academia constantly seeks to establish a boundary, a bulwark or line of defense, inside of which society can continue comfortably without disruption. Most people innately seek and unconsciously...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.